morning, students. So myself, Suman, HOD EC department, and in this semester I am going to teach you the subject Digital IC Applications, DICA. Actually, this subject is continuation for the STLD subject, Switching Theory and Logic Design. So which you already studied that particular subject in your 2-1 semester. So for the better understanding of these particular concepts, so first you have to go through the basics of STLD subject which you learned in your 2-1 semester. Okay, so then after that, in the next semester you are going to study the VLSI design, that is in 3-2 you are going to learn the VLSI design subject. So actually that subject is continuation for this particular Digital IC application subject. So for the better understanding of VLSI design, so you have much idea regarding STLD as well as DICA subjects. And also in this particular Digital IC applications, so you are supposed to learn the programming language, VHDL. Okay, VHDL programming language we are going to learn in this particular DICA subject. Okay, where VHDL is nothing but V stands for VHSIC and HDL. Where VHSIC is nothing but very high speed integrated circuit hardware description language. Okay, so that language we are going to learn in this particular DICA subject, and by means of this particular language students can able to do the VLSI projects. Anyway, in the final year all of you need to do the projects. So many of the students, they will choose either embedded system platform or VLSI. So if you want to do any VLSI project, then you must know the VHDL programming language, where VHSIC HDL stands for very high speed integrated circuit hardware description language. And also in gate point of view also, so you know in syllabus we have the digital electronics. So under that particular digital electronics, majority of questions they will ask from this particular subject. Okay, so by means of considering all this, I can able to say that so this subject is very very important for an ECE students. In that regard, put more concentration on this particular subject. For that, what you are supposed to do is just listen the classes carefully, and whatever the assignments we assign to you, so do it regularly. And also exercise the problems whatever present in our textbook, so that one also you have to practice regularly, then you can able to get much grade. So this is what regarding the importance of our subject. So this will be useful for your gate as well as for doing the projects in the final year, and also for the better understanding of the next semester 3-2 subject VLSI design. So this is what the importance of this particular Digital IC applications subject. Okay then, so before going to discuss about the topics of this particular subject, first let me justify the title of this subject. So what is the title? Digital IC applications. Okay, Digital IC applications. So first let me justify the digital. Okay, as you all know that electronic systems are mainly classified into two types. Those two are, one is analog system, another one is digital system. Okay, so which one is preferable and why, and we will look at so what is analog and what is digital. Okay, so while coming for first analog system, analog systems process time varying signals that can take on any value across a continuous voltage of ranges. So if you look at this particular signal, okay, this is a continuous time varying signal. So if you look at any time it having certain value, by means of that you can able to say it as it's a time varying signal. And also, okay, analog systems can able to take any value across a continuous range of voltages. So like this type of signals, what are all the systems they can able to process such type of signals, those we can able to call them as analog systems. Okay, so this is a time varying signal. If you look at any time, it having continuous range of voltages. Such type of signals they can able to process, those systems we can able to call them as analog systems. And one of the best example for analog system is analog clock itself, where we are using everyone having in our households. Okay, analog clock is the best example for that. And next, digital system. Okay, so while coming for that, so digital systems process time varying signals, and at any time only one of the discrete value it can able to consider. Okay, so that's what. So if you look at this particular signal, so which is a digital signal, so it is also a time varying signals. So if you look at any time, so that signal is continuously varying. Okay, time varying signal. Okay, so that can take on only one of two discrete values. So in this particular case, those two discrete values are either 0 or 1. Okay, so 1 and 0. In another way, you can also use terminology like on, off, or high and low, true and false. Any terminology you can able to use in this particular subject, but the meaning is same. One, you can also mention it as on or high or true. Okay, all terminals are same. Okay, and this is what the digital signal, and it's a time varying signal. At any time it consists of only any one of the two discrete values. So if you look at this particular signal, at any time it consists of either 1 or 0. Such type of signals will be processed by the digital systems. Okay, so one of the best example for that particular one is digital clock. That is the best example for the digital systems. Next, so in these two, so which one is preferable and why? Analog system and digital system. So two systems are there, electronic systems. Which one is preferable? As we are all aware of that, so outside all electronic system, majority of electronic systems are developed by means of using digitals only. Okay, so why? Because digital systems having more advantages compared to analog. Okay, we will see what are all the advantages of that particular digital systems over analog. So in that, first one is, so very easier to design while coming for the digital systems. So compared to analog system, it is very much easy to design the digital system. That is the first advantages of digital. And while coming for the second one, power dissipation is very very low for the digital system. That means power requirement for the digital systems are low compared to the analog systems. So that is the second advantage. And third one is less affected by noise. Okay, so compared to analog systems, so while coming for digital signals, those are all less affected by the noise. Okay, and the fourth one is information storage is easy. Okay, digital information, digital data, where it requires so less space to store a particular data compared with analog. So very small amount area is required to store the digital data compared to analog data. And also in an easy way we can able to store that particular data. So that is also another advantage. And next one is accuracy and precision are easier to maintain throughout this system. So here I mentioned accuracy. So for this, one example you can able to consider it as, so while coming for analog systems, I mentioned analog clock is the example for that. If you look at that particular one, if anyone asked that what is the exact time means, you are supposed to say either 12:05 or 12. So but exact time you can't able to predict. It's around 12:03 around. So but you can't able to say it as an exact way. Most of the times we will mention it as either 12:05 or we will round it off to 12. But while coming for digital, so if you look at this particular one, so in an accurate way you can able to mention that particular time. So it displays the hours, minutes as well as seconds. With that precision you can able to describe a digital system. So because of that, that's what they mentioned. So accuracy and precision, okay, are easier to maintain throughout the system. And next one is operation can be programmed. So initially, as I mentioned, in this particular subject you are going to learn the VHDL programming language. So using of that any particular digital system, you can able to program it. Okay. So because of that operation, any digital circuit operation, you can able to program using VHDL. And one more language, Verilog also there. But anyway, in our syllabus, we are preferring VHDL. Okay. And last one is more circuits can be fabricated on IC chips. Okay. That means digital circuits, they are going to take very less area compared to analog circuits. So because of that, on a given IC chip, you can able to integrate more number of circuits compared to analog. So that is also one of the main advantage. Not only this, several are also there, but these are all the main advantages of digital over analog. But on the other side, so we have certain limitations also on the digital. So those are all. So real world is analog. So outside, majority of signals in the real world are analog signals only. But to process in digital system, first of all, we have to convert them into digital. For that, where it requires analog to digital converter. Then after converting into the digital signals, then only those digital systems can able to process it. And also at the output side, once again, we have to get back our original signal, which is in analog. For that reason, at the output side also, we are supposed to do the digital to analog converter. So that is the first drawback. Because of all our nature concepts of analog signals majority. Okay. So because of that, I can also define the second point. Okay. Based on that. So processing digitized signals takes time. So that is, as I mentioned previously, so before processing digital, using digital systems, we have to convert analog into digital. At the output side also, once again, we have to convert digital into analog. Because of that, at the input side, analog to digital converters are required. At the output side, digital to analog converters are required. So because of that, processing digitized signals takes time. That means more modules are required compared to analog system while coming for digital system. But in analog system, there is no need of conversion. Input is analog, output also analog for that. There is no need of analog A to D converters and D to A converters. So in that regard, processing digitized signals takes time. These are all the limitations for the digital. Okay, so anyway, so considering all these points, we can strongly say that so digital having more advantages than the analog. In that regard only, outside majority of the electronic systems are made up of digital itself. So that is what the justification for the first digital. Okay, digital. And next one is IC, regarding IC. What is an IC? IC is nothing but an integrated circuit. While coming for the definition, IC is a microelectronic semiconductor device consisting of many interconnected active and passive components on it. That means, so on a microelectronic semiconductor, so by means of placing active and passive components, you all know that what are all the active and passive components are nothing but such as so transistors, diode, resistors, capacitors. If you can able to place on that particular microelectronic semiconductor and by means of forming interconnections, if you can able to achieve a functionality, that itself we can able to consider it as an IC. So that is what the definition for that. So who invented IC? Jock Kilby in the year 1958. Jock Kilby in the year 1958. Okay, he also got Nobel Prize for this particular achievement. And this is how, so ICs are seems to be. Mainly it consists of three parts. So integrated, circuit, okay, package and pins. So actually this particular IC, internally it is going to present on top of it package, we are going to place, and in addition to that, to communicate with the external world, we are supposed to place the pins over there. That is how the structure seems to be. And these are all the some of the ICs, okay. So that is what IC. So I gave justification for digital as well as IC, and so applications throughout this particular DECA subject. So we are going to model the digital ICs by means of using the VHDL programming language. Anyway, you studied in your STLD the concepts like adder, subtractor, multiplier, demultiplexer, encoder, decoder. So all these operations you studied. So in this particular DECA subject, so we have to model all those by means of using VHDL, and we are supposed to realize the digital ICs. And later on we are going to study about applications of that particular digital ICs. So because of that, so this particular subject named it as digital IC applications. So because digital ICs we are going to modeling using of VHDL language, and after realizing that particular one, we are supposed to discuss about the applications of those particular digital ICs. So because of that, the title of the subject, they mentioned it as digital IC applications. So next, course objectives. Okay, so these are all the objectives. Okay, while coming for the first one, introduction of digital logic families and interfacing concepts for digital design is considered. So that is nothing but in the first unit of DECA subject. So you are going to learn about what are all the different digital logic families that we have, and in all those, which logic families are so popular and why. After that, how to form interfacing between those popular logic families, that we are going to learn in our first unit of DECA subject. Okay, next, VHDL. Second objective is VHDL fundamentals were discussed to modeling the digital system design blocks. So in the second unit, you are going to learn about the programming language VHDL. Okay, very high speed integrated circuit hardware description language. Okay, so by means of knowing that particular language, so you can able to model any digital circuits. So how you can able to model, that we are going to learn in this particular second unit. And third one is, objective is VHDL compilers, simulators and synthesis tools are described, which are used to verify digital systems in a technology independent fashion. So in the third unit, you are going to learn about, so once if you developed a program for all these circuits, then we are supposed to verify the functionality. To verify that particular functionality, whether it is working properly or not. So these are all the tools that particular VHDL it consists of. Compiler, simulator, synthesis. These are all the tools that VHDL consists of. So based on that particular tools, you can able to verify the operation, what we developed a program for that particular, okay, digital circuits. Okay, that you are going to learn in the third unit. And after that, last objective is design and implementation of combinational and sequential digital logic circuits is explained in 4th, 5th and 6th unit. So based on the first two units, what you learned, what are all the different logic families, in the first unit you learned how to form interfacing, and in 2nd and 3rd unit you are going to learn about the programming language VHDL, and by means of using those tools, compiler, simulator, so you can able to verify the functionality of that particular whatever program you wrote over there. And based on that, now we are in a position that any combinational and sequential, synchronous as well as asynchronous circuits, all these, how you can able to design by means of using that particular VHDL, or we are going to discuss in the 4th, 5th and 6th units. So that is what the course objectives of this particular digital IC applications subject. And these are all the recommended textbooks. Okay, so first one is Digital Design Principles and Practices by John F. Walker Lee. So this is very, very important while coming to the digital designing. So whenever a student would like to do digital, so designing of circuits, then so they need to consider this particular one. So very, very important for a digital design point of view. Okay, Digital Design Principles and Practices by John F. Walker Lee. So most probably all the 6 units, majority of concepts was covered in that particular textbook itself. Okay, so because of that, you have to take care about this particular one. If possible, you can also buy it. Okay, so then second one is VHDL Primer by J. Bhaskar. As I mentioned previously, VHDL language we are supposed to learn in this particular subject. So regarding that particular VHDL, it gives a detailed description. Okay, so VHDL Primer by J. Bhaskar. And next, the third one is Fundamentals of Digital Logic with VHDL Design by Stephen Brown. Okay, using of that particular VHDL, how you are going to design a digital circuits. So that will be well described in this particular textbook. Okay, so all these three are good enough. Okay, so for the better understanding of this particular Dekas subject, but in all these three, this one is much more preferable. Okay, as per our syllabus point of view, as well as to get more knowledge in the digital design. Okay, so these are all the recommended textbooks. Then let me start the first unit, so which is digital logic families and interfacing. And in this particular unit, we are going to learn about what are all the different digital logic families that we have, and what are all the popular logic families in those, and why, and how to form interconnection, interfacing between those popular, okay, logic families. That's what you are going to learn in this particular first unit. Okay, so in that, the first topic is introduction to logic families. Okay, so in early 1930s, electronic circuits are designed by means of using relays. Okay, using relays, we can also call it as magnetically controlled switches. Okay, and relays, where their operation is as simple as like switch only they are going to operate. Switch is nothing but only they can able to perform on and off. Okay, so relays, they are going to do only on and off operation. They can't able to do any mathematical operations. And also, even nowadays, we are using in our railway safety system these particular relays. And this is how relays are seems to be. Okay, so top and bottom view here mentioned. Okay, this is how the relays are seems to be. Okay, it acts like a switch. That's it. And after that, in the mid of 1940s, okay, first digital computer was realized using of vacuum tubes. Okay, first digital computer, so which is ENIAC, Electronic Numerical Integrator and Computer. ENIAC stands for Electronic Numerical Integrator and Computer. That is the first digital system for the general purpose. So they developed, so using of vacuum tubes, that too in the year 1946. Okay, in the year 1946. But the drawback of that particular, even though that is the first digital system, there are so many drawbacks are present in that particular ENIAC. So those are mainly, okay, that main drawback is its structure itself. If you look at the structure, so where it requires 18,000 vacuum tubes. 18,000 vacuum tubes are required to design that particular one, and it is 80 feet long and 8.5 feet height, and 1 lakh watts of power is required. Okay, so it's very bulky in structure. How means? Where it consists of 18,000 vacuum tubes in it, and 80 feet long and 8.5 feet height, and to operate that particular operations where it requires 1 lakh watts of power. So because of all these, okay, so those are all not that much popular. Okay, but this is the first digital system developed by the vacuum tubes. And after that, commercial purpose computers are realized. So where the first one is UNIVAC 1, Universal Automatic Computer 1. Okay, so this is the first commercial purpose, and ENIAC is the general purpose computer, and UNIVAC was developed in the year 1951. Okay, and this is how the vacuum tubes are seems to be. Okay, both ENIAC and UNIVAC are designed by means of using vacuum tubes only. For both, the drawbacks are their structure itself. So this much configuration is required to design that particular one. So these are all the main drawbacks of that particular one. Okay, then after that, so in the year 1947, transistor was invented by, okay, John Burdin, William Shockley and Walter Brittain. Okay, John Burdin, William Shockley and Walter Brittain. So this is how the transistor seems to be. Okay, so then after that, once they developed that particular transistor, so then thereafter several BJT logic families are developed. So initially all these are all they considered the discrete components, but once in the year 1958, after realization of the IC was invented by Jock Kilby in the year 1958. Once IC was introduced, then thereafter, so all the logic families, BJT logic families, they are developed using of that particular, okay, ICs itself. So here I mentioned those logic families in that particular BJT. So RTL, resistor transistor logic, direct coupled transistor logic, diode transistor logic, transistor transistor logic, emitter coupled logic, we can also known as current mode logic, integrated injection logic, and high threshold logic. Okay, so but in all these you are supposed to remember two. Those two are transistor transistor logic and emitter coupled logic. These two are popular in all these different BJT logic families. So why TTL is popular means because of its capability of high integration density. So it is having an advantage of high integration density. Integration density. So what it means? High integration density is nothing but where we can able to integrate more number of transistors. So on that particular IC compared to remaining all technologies. If you can able to place more number of transistors, obviously it can able to perform more functionalities compared to remaining one. So because of that, so we prefer so transistor transistor logic. More than 90% of BJT ICs are made up of TTL itself. Next, another popular one is emitter coupled logic. So this we preferred because of its high speed. The main advantage of ECL is its high speed. Okay. So, but the drawback of ECL is it's very complex to design and also so cost as well. So because of that, wherever high speed is necessary, like our supercomputers, in such applications we are going to prefer this particular emitter coupled logic. Okay, so this is what regarding the bipolar logic families. And next, so then after that, okay, then after that MOS logic families were introduced. So in the early 1970s, okay, so MOSFETs were introduced. But in reality, in 1925 itself, J. Lilienfeld, okay, proposed a patent on the basic principle behind the MOSFET. But at that time, so because of insufficient knowledge of the materials and also gate stability problems, they are not coming to the picture. So at that time, BJT logic families are developed. Once they resolved those issues, gate stability problems in the year 1970s, so then thereafter MOSFET logic families were introduced. In that, the first logic family they developed is PMOS family. PMOS, you can able to call it as P-channel MOSFETs. MOSFETs are nothing but metal oxide semiconductor field effect transistor. So by means of using PMOS, we can able to, at that time they realized the calculators. Okay. And while coming for next one is NMOS family. NMOS you can able to call it as N-channel MOSFETs. By means of using them, initially they developed the first microprocessors by Intel. So in the year 1971, 4004. And in the year 1974, 8080. All these are all developed using of this particular NMOS technology. And later to that, CMOS family. Where CMOS family you can able to realize by means of combining both NMOS and PMOS. Okay, so CMOS only majority we are considering because of its advantages, mainly two advantages it have. So those two are, so first one is high integration density, and second one is low power dissipation. So these two are very very important for any logic family. And these two you can able to achieve by means of using CMOS technology. Because of that, nowadays all digital circuits are made up of this particular CMOS family itself, where you can able to achieve this by means of combining both PMOS and NMOS. Okay,
and after that the last one is one more also developed by CMOS. So how we can able to achieve this particular one is by means of combining both bipolar as well as CMOS technologies on a single semiconductor device. So why they considered such as like that means, so CMOS having certain advantages like what I described over here, high integration density and low power dissipation. And while coming for bipolars, they have, because of its output low impedance, where it can able to drive the large currents at the output side, because of that high fan out is possible at the output side. If I want all these advantages in a single place, then I have to go for the bi-CMOS. By means of placing both bipolar and CMOS on a single place, a single IC, I can able to get all these advantages. But the main drawback of bi-CMOS is, so interfacing between bipolars and CMOS formation seems to be very very difficult. So realization of bi-CMOS circuits is complex as well as costly. So because of that, so nowadays all electronic systems, they are made up of CMOS technology only. So this is what regarding the, okay, so introduction to the logic families. Let me summarize whatever I discussed till now. So first I mentioned the importance of our subject, because of in gate it has certain priority. To learn the VLSI design, it will be helpful, and to do the projects also it will be helpful. And after that I mentioned the importance of digital, because of digital having so many advantages over analog, like low power dissipation, in an easy way you can able to design, and information storage is easy. So because of all these reasons, we preferred digital over analog. And while coming for the first unit, introduction to the logic families, initially electronic circuits are realized by means of relays. After that they moved on to the vacuum tubes. After that they are realized by means of discrete components. Once IC was invented, then thereafter all logic families are developed using of ICs. And after that MOSFETs were introduced. Then thereafter, okay, several MOSFET logic families are developed. In all those MOSFET logic families, CMOS is much more preferable because of its high integration density as well as low power dissipation. Okay, anyway, thank you very much. Thank you.